Please?
Yes.
All right, first item is to review and approve the minutes from February 19th. I don't have any comments to make on them myself.
I had one, just to clarify. We talked about the bridges in here, and we've got what? Gotta get the right set of minutes, I guess. Is there one more than one?
It should be on page one. Is it on the first page, Trent?
Okay, we had a meeting since then, though.
Yeah.
So there's minutes, and then it's on the next page there.
Yeah, what's on the bottom of page one, that first pair, the last paragraph? Is that weird?
Yeah, oh, okay.
Okay.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay.
It's really true. Okay.
Motion to make sense.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Great. Okay. Excuse me. Item two, vendor and payroll warrants. I signed those the other day. Are there any comments?
No.
No? Okay. Now ready for public comment. I don't see a lot of members of the public. I know Richard's here for something on the agenda. Do you have anything to say that's not on the agenda? Okay, nothing about like COVID-19? No? Okay, all right. I'm trying to help people get PSA material here.
I have a friend of mine had his self
had self warranty.
He teaches in Rome.
Wow.
And we were going to meet, and I got a phone call. I said, just got an email. So he's sitting
So it is coming into Western. Coming into Western Mass, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay.
We don't have a good test for it.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So much for having all the information at your fingertips. Okay. So there's no further public comment then. The first appointment of the day is Richard Tilbert, who's requesting that we send a letter to support H935, an act establishing the Massachusetts Infrastructure Bank. So why don't I let Richard tell us more about it?
Okay. I have heard comments. They generally reflect what I had written. So okay. I can either give you the comments or in the interest of time,
I can
try to respond to questions.
I would say summarize, because people at home may also be interested.
Okay. I'm a member of the steering committee for the statewide public bank. For H935, and the idea is we would like to ask the Select Board's support to have that bill become law. Why do we need a public bank? We've got a lot of banks in the Commonwealth. The first thing is it's part of the efforts to make the economic system more democratic. And you can go back to the recession of 2008, you can go to the Occupy Wall Street movement, and even the Tea Party movement, when it was first starting, these had to do with trying to bring the economic decision-making back to the public sphere and not Wall Street. So this is, first of all, a part of that movement. Secondly, it focuses the Commonwealth's attention on infrastructure development. As we all know, infrastructure in the Commonwealth is deficient. We've gotten a D from the American Society of Civil Engineers, and it's not going away.
Yeah, we have many items on here regarding the infrastructure.
Oh, bridges, right. Okay.
We're very well aware.
Okay, so you're well aware of that. So briefly, what is a public bank? The first thing to say is it's a regular bank. It's like any other bank, with some very important exceptions. It's publicly owned. The only shareholder is the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So there's no demand to have a quick buck and to get a big turnaround and to lend for the highest loan and lend anywhere in the world for any kind of project. It can make only defined loans. Public banks can have a defined set of loans. In this case, it happens to be only infrastructure projects. There would be no private depositors, no branches, no ATMs, which means it's a lot cheaper to operate. The chief financial officers and all senior staff would have pay commensurate with with state employees, not with CEOs of Wall Street firms. And very importantly, and I'm going to pick on this point a couple of times, it does not compete with either commercial banks, Massachusetts commercial banks, or with Massachusetts agencies, MassDOT, Mass Development, Mass Works. It actually helps them do their jobs better. How would it work? Well, it would be created by legislation. It would have a board of directors appointed by the governor, the speaker, and the Senate president. It would be capitalized with $50 million from state funds. And this is where the state ends up owning the bank, is that it says we're going to have this money. And the state would put $350 million of deposits into the bank, would keep that deposit level. Seems like a lot of money, but the state right now has about $1.9 to $2 billion in money market banks, short-term deposits, long-term deposits. You pay a tax 3 weeks from now, it becomes somebody's salary. So this churning of money, $350 million, which is now going into money market banks, would go into the public bank, which helps it make loans. Very important to us out here, board of directors will represent small cities as well as big cities, and every region in the Commonwealth will have representation. This is not a Boston-centric bank. It is a bank that Brian can call, anybody in the Commonwealth can call, say, I need $100,000 for this infrastructure. How do we do that? It's not a new idea. Public banks have been around forever. They were public banks in colonial days. They went out of business, particularly they went out of favor. The most recent modern is the Bank of North Dakota. I don't know if you're all familiar.
Yep.
Okay, 1919, I won't go into that. It's a wonderful thing, it's never failed. It's helped North Dakota get through both the Great Depression and the 2008 recession. To pick up on the agenda that it does not compete with community banks, North Dakota has more banking and credit union entities per capita than any other state in the country. California just adopted legislation allowing cities to set up their public banks. In this case, it would be the Commonwealth in California. Los Angeles can set up its own public bank. The public banks are being considered in Oregon, state of Washington, Pennsylvania, New Mexico, Washington, D.C. It's an idea. Of course, there are many, many public banks in foreign countries. Why should we support it? Well, as I discussed before, it helps democratize the economic system. And it takes the money supply out of these money center banks and puts it into the state of Massachusetts. Its loan structure fills unmet needs, and I'm going to go through a few of them. Banks, you can borrow money from banks. But the thing about a community bank, you have somebody coming into the community bank in the morning and getting a house mortgage, and you have Brian coming in the afternoon asking for an infrastructure loan. And the loan officer is torn many, many ways. The public bank would simply be one use infrastructure development. There's a number of state agencies, as I said, MassDOT, MassWorks. But these, you have to stand in line to get the money. These are mandated to increase tax revenues and to increase jobs, which infrastructure doesn't always do. You build a road, you have to stretch to kind of say that it increases things over time, but it just generally helps the community. You can't make a nexus very easily. Grants are free money. What's wrong with that? Except that you have to fit your project to your grant. You have to wait for the appropriation. If you need something today and the grant is not available today, you sit back and twiddle your thumbs until next year. The public bank would be flexible, one-stop shopping. It would be focused and it would have efficient loan review. Whately needs some money. You call the bank because there's no branches, so you call in Boston. You know what the loan review process is. You know what the loan docs are because you've done this before. The person on the other end of the phone has done this before. You get a yes or a no. The business I used to be in, we used to have a statement that no is the second best answer. The best answer is yes. Maybe is the worst answer, because maybe is going to eventually be a no after you've spent 6 months screwing around with it. And so in this case, you don't get a maybe. You don't get, let me talk to the loan committee, let me do this. And gee, we've never seen this before. Yes, no, no. I brought up the Williamsburg Road thing. I noticed it's on the agenda. You've been saving money to fund the difference between the grant and the actual cost. Had there been an infrastructure bank, Whately could have taken the choice of borrowing that money at a relatively low interest rate. Right now, it's probably 2% or less, and then paying it back from the cash as it comes in. I'm talking above my pay grade here, but there's Chapter 90 money as that comes in. The advantage of this kind of process is when you go to the bank, you say, I'm going to pay it back from Chapter 90 money. You're not saying, I'm going to pay it back because this ice cream company that I want to finance is really going to make $1 million on this, trust me. So the banker says, Chapter 90, he can look and say, yeah, that's it, we're done. To recap, the bank would funnel Massachusetts money back into Massachusetts. It stands for the proposition that public should have some of the same privileges as Wall Street. It will be backed by secure loans. It's not likely to, you know, become another AIG or another Lehman Brothers or anything of that sort. And it will work with existing community banks to help them. If you go to the bank and you need 300 grand and the bank can only lend you 200 grand, you don't shake hands and walk away. You say, let me make a phone call. For these reasons, we've attached a letter of support. Trust me, there is no ego in the letter. If you wish to make any modifications to it, I would be more than happy to. And we'd like you to take a positive action to show your support for H-935. And I'd be more than happy to take questions from the audience.
I've actually known about the work on the infrastructure bank for more than 10 years. I have a friend, you may even know her, from the eastern part of the state, who'd been working on this for a long time. And I've personally written letters to our legislators to try and get this to work in the past. Is there any reason why we think, like now, that this H-935 has got some momentum? I mean, you mentioned some other states are looking at it and, right, and have adopted things.
I don't know, but I could surmise that the recession and the results of the bailout and all of that, is everything has been percolating, and it turns out that things are starting to bubble to the surface now, and you're getting interest. And you know, the first 5 years after that, it was everybody saying, let's socialize everything, and yeah, that doesn't work. So now you get people who wear coats and ties, and they're saying, how can we help with this system? That's my guess, but I can't say I know.
Okay. That's all I was going to ask. Do you have any questions?
Yeah, a couple here. You say this is in here, is this for the forgotten middle? So projects be less, well, between 1 million and 10 million. Is that the only range that they're considering?
No. And in fact, after I wrote that, and then I started to think, oh yeah, Whately.
We don't have, so far we haven't had any over a million yet.
I know. And in fact, in the presentation, I didn't bring that up. What the idea is that if you want to go 10 million or more, you get a bond, and that's okay. If you want to go smaller, you know, that's where this can help. So there's no limitation as to the minimum size. It's just a limitation on how much effort you want to put into any particular activity. There's no point in borrowing $10,000 probably because the cost of paperwork will exceed that. If you want to borrow $50,000, I don't know, the Williamsburg Road deficit is 180 or something. That would be a perfect number.
You mentioned a board of directors here, 9 members.
Yeah.
Are they actually going to administer these funds, or is there a group of employees under them?
Oh, yes.
Going to do all that?
Okay, so the structure, and I didn't want to get into that detail, but the structure is the board of directors is a typical board of directors. Then they have a board of advisors who meet quarterly. So the directors, I'm not sure when they meet, I think it's monthly. They will hire a president, and the president will then hire the staff underneath him or her.
This will all be located in Boston, I guess, or where would all this be?
Well, in modern communications, you could be on the board of directors, and they would meet monthly, and you would simply telephone in. So I think no one knows where the offices would be. My bet is the offices are going to be in Boston. But it doesn't mean that the bill specifically says all regions, all sizes of town. So this region will have a director. This region will have a director sitting on the board of directors.
What is defined? What's this region?
I don't know. I don't want to say things that are not in the legislation. So the legislation, in fact, I can read it. The legislation says, the board will be, the bank will be governed by 9 members appointed. Members will serve 4-year staggered terms. The membership shall be made up of representatives of both small and large municipalities and representatives of the several regions of the Commonwealth. That's what it says. This is legislation, and so it tends to be, you know, then you're going to get some department is going to actually create regulations to implement the legislation.
So you're just asking us to support this concept that has nothing to do with whether we're eligible in the future for
I'm sorry,
applying.
Can you read that?
All you're asking is to support this legislation.
Yes.
It has no bearing on whether we apply in the future for funds or anything. So anybody else, any other community can apply. Even if they don't support this.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Okay. It would be like any other piece of legislation.
Right? Yeah. Okay.
It's simply what we're trying to do now, and this kind of responds to your comment. Not surprisingly, there's a fair amount of things against the banking industry is against this piece of legislation. The second
I'm
thing
so
is
shocked. I am just so shocked to find.
You, yeah.
I'm shocked.
And the other thing that's happening, and we spoke with Representative Connolly, and his point was, there is opposition, but there's also, this is something economic. It's not really sexy. And so there's also, why do we want to deal with this now? Let's deal with it later. We've been trying to get this bill passed for some time. So the new thrust is to try to get local municipalities, Whately, to say, hey guys, wake up, we really need this. And so what I'm going to do, if you all are willing to show your support, I'm going to take this to other towns and try to do the same thing. I'm going to talk to our representatives, other people, I mean, not just me, but there are 12 or 13 people on the steering committee, and I'm kind of the Western Mass representative. So, but no, even if you, heaven forbid, decided not to support, and it, became law, you could still apply, obviously, you could still make an application.
What's your timeframe for that? What do you say is the timeframe? No, you can't predict, but what do you say is happening with this timeline?
The answer is yes. It's in the 191st session. It doesn't look like it's going anywhere soon. We're trying this new emphasis. The old emphasis was talk to representatives, talk to senators, you know, da-da-da-da-da. Do it because it's a good thing. That's not working. So what we're trying now is to get a groundswell. And groundswells, as you all know, takes time. And somebody has to be the first to actually bring
it up.
Will
we be the first?
Yeah.
Oh, I think we should do that.
Yeah.
I absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And we could have it, you know, instead of Whately being at the bottom of the alphabet, Whately could be.
Yeah.
I mean, it's,
okay.
Do you know if there's plans to refile in January?
I'm sorry.
The legislative session ends.
Like this at the end of the year.
End of the year.
Yeah.
June. But the formal session.
It's been filed every year for the last 20 years.
So
as
far as I assume there's plans to refile in January.
Oh yeah. Yeah. It was filed last year under a different number.
Yeah.
There's plans to, well,
yeah.
Since we live in hope, there are no plans to refile because it'll be adopted.
Mm-hmm. But, it's
but in the unlikely event it's not adopted, yes.
Well, I would say let's sign this. Should we need a vote? Can't hurt. I move that we sign on to this.
Good, second.
Sure.
All in favor?
Aye.
So I'll draft.
You take the word draft out.
Draft out and let her head in. I'll have
okay.
Joyce sign it. Is that?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
And what I'd like to do is to get back with my folks and to see where they think would be the best people to mail it to.
Okay.
And I'll get that to you. What's today? Wednesday. I'll get that to you by the end of the week.
And obviously, copy our reps.
And
yeah,
it would be. And can we get all three members?
You want all three signatures? Or
if it's possible. If it's not possible.
I don't think there's any. I wouldn't.
Okay.
I get to sign anyway.
I'm.
We'll ask.
My daddy once said, Richard, when you get a yes, leave.
Oh, yeah. Don't sell past the.
So
yes.
However you want to handle that is just fine.
Okay.
Brian, I'll be in touch with you.
Okay.
Okay, thank you all very much.
Okay,
thanks.
Thank you, Richard.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, on to old business. To discuss the status of the sidewalk reconstruction project on Chestnut Plain Road. Oh, Keith is not here yet. Okay, let's, I guess that discussion will be short. And the Williamsburg Road Bridge project would also be. Okay, so let's put old business off for a moment and see if we can get through some of these new businesses. This meeting's going to be short. There are no poll hearings.
Yeah.
Okay, anyhow, new business. To discuss the condition of equipment at the highway department. Boy, this is something like Keith related to get here.
I grouped all of us together, see? So
and then personnel committee, there's Keith again on the personnel committee. All right, well, let's go up to 6C.
Well, we can do personnel, can't we? It's not the.
All right, well, I'm on personnel too, but.
Oh.
Yeah, we can do that without Keith. He's, I think, the chair of the personnel committee. That's
okay. We'll do these other things maybe first.
Okay, and then we'll come back to that if he's not down. That'll be the first one we do without him. Okay, so to discuss and vote to renew the seasonal alcohol license for Quan Quan Farm. There's just a seasonal, it's like a 6-month license.
May of October.
They haven't had any trouble in the past.
I haven't heard of anything, though.
I don't have any objection to renewing that.
Do they sign three of them?
So, yes. They have to sign the top one, just stating that there's no non-renewals.
Amy's our licensing expert, so.
No, far.
This pen is purple and it's erasable, so could I borrow one?
Perfect.
Yeah.
As far as I know, I don't have the coronavirus.
That's okay. I was not going to lick the pen after all.
Just trying to get him his clip and his cut.
There we go. And fret too?
Yes.
Yep.
There we go.
And obviously the license. What about the top one?
Let me see which one you're.
Here.
They have to sign down below there. Yep, that's just to say that you're accepting the manager of Quonset's, her last name, and, well, her first name was spelled wrong.
That's Whately Dunn.
Oh.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry.
Right?
No, that form?
Susan O'Neill.
Oh, no, I'm sorry, you're right.
Yeah, okay.
You're right.
I'm sorry, Greg, what was that?
That's, didn't say Quonset on there.
No, this is only for who failed to renew.
The name on it.
And who you disapproved, which is no one, so.
And then here is the actual license for Quonset.
The one that's getting framed. So make this one neat.
So that's just that you're all allowing to change her name on the license, because she, I think maybe she got married or her last.
Her legal name changed.
Exactly.
But same person.
Same person.
Okay. All right, so next item is to discuss the location of the 2020 annual town meeting. So I assume this discussion is really about the two venues we have in town that are, well, large enough, at least in theory, would be the upstairs room at the newly renovated town hall.
Yeah.
There's also the gym at the school where we had it for years and years. And we say those two places primarily because they're wheelchair accessible. I don't know that there's any other venues that are not accessible, but for example, this meeting room is probably too small.
Yeah.
This one. So those are the kind of the two options. And last year, I believe we did it at the town hall. I remember it being a bit crowded.
Yeah.
And kind of cramped. And given that there is some possibility that coronavirus will still be an issue at that point, cramming 100 people into a room that really fits about 100 might not be the greatest idea. The gym at the school is more spacious. You can have spaces between people a little more readily. People can hang in the back or spread out a bit more. Am I missing any possibilities that we should be considering?
For locations?
For locations.
Other than an open field, which I don't think we're going to do.
No,
those are the two. Yeah. I know the feedback that I got about the town hall, the difficulties we had with the town hall were, because of the small space. I know FCAT had some issues setting up.
Yeah.
In terms of space wise, correct me if I'm wrong. The sound quality wasn't as desired as they would have liked. And then we had issues setting up in front with Select Board and Finance Committee, and then
the moderator. It was very crowded.
It's a difficult configuration because we're not using the stage.
Right. If we were using the stage, and if the screen were back a little further, that would facilitate it, but I don't see that changing.
Right.
Not in the near term anyway.
Right. And I talked with Fran Fortino from the Board of Health, and talked to him twice today, and when I talked with him just before the meeting, I just got off the conference call with Mass DPH, and he made the suggestion that that town meeting, if it's going to be held in April, and that's another discussion that we should have about options. Their preference would be that it would be in the elementary school, because it provides more space for people to spread out. One of the issues, obviously, with what's going around right now is close contact, as they think how it's passed.
Yeah.
So the farther apart and the less cramming we can do, probably the better for everybody.
Yep. I completely agree with that. Just coming from my place of employment there. They held the faculty meeting today in a room that holds 300, and there's not 300 faculty. There are about 100 of us joined by Zoom. About 100-ish were in the actual room, and they told people not to sit next to each other. They were all spread out through the whole room. So it's serious enough, I think. that we should go over to the elementary school this year. Do you have any anything to add?
Forgetting about the virus issue for now, I guess, you know, I guess still am chairman of the municipal building committee, and one of our objectives that I kept emphasizing was the need to have a meeting space for town meetings and large functions for the town. I hear what Brian is saying, and I hear the reasons, and I guess I can agree, but I just can't consciously say we're going to go back to the elementary school. I guess that would not be my decision. If maybe you want to wait till the next meeting when we have a full board to talk about it and decide, but today I can't support that.
When do we have to post the location?
With the warrant, so it'll be in the middle of April. FCAT was, Chris Collins was wondering where the location was going to be. Yeah, I think it helps them in planning because there's going to be two different sets of equipment. It just helps them planning, but there's not an immediate need to decide.
It may be that we decide this year differently, and I agree with you. Last year, when the first time we weren't able to do it there, I was really wanting to try that out. And I know there were problems, but I don't think the problems are insurmountable.
No, we could rearrange.
So I agree with you on that. But just from my experience of the last few days regarding, you know, the things that work for helping prevent infection are washing your hands, using hand sanitizer, and avoiding contact with large numbers of people. Those are the three things that work.
With that?
So it might be that that's just for this year, and we can put off the decision until April.
Okay. Well, if that's a major concern, and a concern in the next whatever couple of weeks, well, then I guess we could maybe hold off and decide then what we're doing. I guess right now I think it may be too early.
Okay, yeah, because it doesn't actually say to vote on, just to discuss today.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so we want to keep that as an ongoing discussion.
Okay.
I think that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Next item was to discuss priority capital needs to be submitted to Representative Blaze. And that's about where I didn't get necessarily all of the reading done that you gave.
Yep, so Natalie's this staff person, I don't know her official title, Lily Wallace sent this form out that's in your packet. And it says, please email your community's top two budget priorities by 5 p.m., so like an hour ago on 3/11/2020. It's okay for us to submit tomorrow morning.
Okay.
But I've also noticed that the amount requested did not to exceed $50,000, so I'm not sure what we're going to get done for less than $50,000.
Well, what's on our capital approval
for our
budget?
Top two budget priorities, but...
Does it have to be like a whole project in there, or it could be a contribution to a project that costs more and this will help us achieve it without blowing our whole capital budget?
I guess presumably it could be... It could be a component of a portion of a
cost share sort of thing.
Yeah.
Is this new projects or something that's already underway?
Yeah, I would suspect the way that it would operate, it would have to be a new project, unless it's a long-term project. Because I'm not even sure when, if they had $100,000 to give away, I'm not even sure it would be now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's no timeline on this.
No. I think this helps inform the House discussion of the budget, the budget that's currently being debated.
I don't think I have my capital.
So I mean, one of the top ones, I guess, or one of the the one, the top one that we've been discussing, the accessibility improvements at the library.
That was the one I thought, wasn't that more like $200,000?
Yeah, it's $100,000.
Or $100,000.
$150,000.
Yeah.
But depending on the outcome at the town meeting, and we may already appropriate the money, doesn't mean we'd gladly use somebody else's money, of course.
Right.
And another thought that I had is, at some point, we're going to need to start paying for design of future projects that we're going to want to accomplish, whether that be infrastructure or building projects.
Yeah.
We certainly have a lot of culverts to replace, and there's design money that is going to need to be spent or found somewhere.
I see. So nothing, I know the Finance Committee and the Capital Improvement Committee actually have lists and prioritize capital projects.
Yep.
Are you saying maybe we don't go for one of those, but ask instead for this, excuse me, design then?
I think those are two options.
What about the other one you're struggling with, Brian, with the school energy improvements?
Yeah, I mean, that was...
I mean, that's something you're into right now. Maybe these others, too, you suggested, rather than the library, is coming up soon. But the culvert one, I don't know.
Right. That one's far enough away. I mean, because the school doesn't, it's eligible for other sources of state and federal funding. Well, state funding via green communities.
Right.
So it's hard to say from the way they ask it, but I would assume if it's eligible for other sources, this would be a lower priority. Right?
Yeah.
These funds could be used for anything. It's not clear whether total costs are could use for construction, for design as well.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, the one obvious one is the library.
Yeah.
Handicapped accessibility.
I think that's
at the library.
Yeah, okay.
Even though your community's top two budget priorities for something that might never get funded. So we're not going to send our top two priorities, because those would be things that we absolutely have to get funded. Two, but, yeah. I mean, do you understand what I'm struggling with there?
Yeah.
Where do we stand with the funding, say, for the water merger?
I think we have the funds that we need.
We have that, but I mean, I guess that's a priority. Maybe we got the funds, but
yeah,
well, I don't know what she would do for with that. Was that give us a $50,000 to contribute towards the total cost?
I'm not optimistic that.
This will come to anything?
Yeah.
Well, I think putting in one about, I kind of like the, in some ways I like the pairing, because we get to ask for two. The accessibility at the library is a real infrastructure issue. And then having money for design for other kinds of infrastructure is an issue that money's hard to come by. It's never really included in the grant. You need to do all that up front before you can get a grant. So it's sort of like seed money in a way. So I like those two. And in the absence, I can't find the list of things that they were considering for capital. But they were all very hardware sort of things.
Yeah. I'm wondering if Keith and I have had some discussions, and Fred's been involved a little bit, about the culvert on Christian Lane. If we want to get specific about the design money we need, right, Fred, we would need money to design that culvert.
Yeah.
next to the kind of Castaways is at the intersection of 5 and 10 Christian Lane. We're trying to put together a grant for, that would pay for design, but there's no guarantees. So the Division of Ecological Restoration, because that brook is a cold water tributary, cold water fishery stream, or it has higher.
It's got higher
diversity. It has a better score, let's put it that way.
Yeah.
But if we needed to get specific, that's somewhere we could definitely use.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Money.
Yeah, and that's part of the intersection that involves the state highway. And I just noticed today, driving by real slow, that the culvert on State Road is deteriorating, and it looks like something needs to be done there. So it's not like this is the only one at that intersection. And if you're going to be dealing with wetlands,
South of the intersection?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh.
You can see it from the road, the west side of that culvert on State Road is deteriorating, I could tell. So any work there is going to involve the wetlands. So if you're going to do it for there or Christian Lane, I think it would make sense to do them at the same time.
Right.
So, and of course, it's a bigger project, the whole intersection, rather than just the culverts. But it's a start, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So do we want to do the library
accessibility
improvements and then the design money for Christian Lane
culvert? Yes, sure. Okay.
That sounds good.
Okay. Last item under new business. Keith, TikTok. Okay. To discuss a request for additional stage lighting in the town hall auditorium. And this I also did not read much about in here.
Yeah, so there's a request from, it was originally a request from Paul Newland.
Uh-huh.
It came through the Friends of Town Hall group, who still has some additional funds that they've raised for the town hall, or they've raised additional funds, but it would pay for the installation of lighting onto the stage. One of the problems that I was told exists is that when people on stage are standing towards the front of the stage, that there are shadows and it's dark because the lights are further back.
Correct.
So they're willing to make a donation and purchase additional lighting that would shine onto the stage. I think we would want probably to see what it looks like, see what the lights look like before they're, give them.
Yeah,
go ahead to give us a proposal on what it's going to look like, and then.
Yeah.
But in terms of the concept, is the board okay with that?
Yeah.
Sure. Yes.
And there's energy efficient lights. I'm sure they're already thinking of that.
Yes.
Yeah, they just show us some design.
Speaking of poorly fitted energy efficient lights, Eversource has agreed to replace the one in the outside. It's energy efficient, but
again?
Well, they have not replaced it from the original one.
Oh, okay.
But that was not a great choice, so.
Okay.
They're gonna be replacing that. Maybe we'll move that one inside, it'll light up the whole.
There you go.
Light up the whole room.
Yeah, the audience will be able to read while watching, right. Okay.
So I'll communicate that to the Friends of Town Hall.
All right, and then it's town administrator updates, unless we can go backwards and
start
peeling things off.
About me, sure.
Yeah.
Either way, whatever we want to do is fine.
Right.
We'll give them a couple more minutes.
If you want to go through your updates, then we'll, it'll be more efficient to do it while he's here.
The Black Birch Vineyard tent. Excuse me, 10-miler event has been postponed.
Okay.
Since this afternoon, Amy got an email to September 13th.
Okay.
To avoid a large gathering of people. my understanding.
Okay.
Just a reminder, we have this, the meeting with the Center School Vision and Committee.
On next Thursday.
Yep, March 19th. We'll skip over this one, we'll get back to that one. Haynesville Road Project status update. There's going to be a meeting.
April 17th.
When is that, April?
April 17th.
Yeah. Between Whately, Williamsburg, BVPC, FERCog, Mass District 1, Mass District 2, and our representatives. So, and really the purpose of that meeting is to try to get convince Mass DOT to continue design beyond 25% threshold.
Okay.
So it's, we're trying to get everybody in a single room to see how we can move forward. Because as you remember, the project crosses two municipalities, two planning organizations, transportation planning organizations, two Mass DOT districts, two planning agencies.
It's a hard line.
It's complicated.
Yeah.
So the Whately Elementary School energy efficiency upgrades. So I was able to meet with a weatherization vendor. We have quotes for the boiler upgrades. We spent about 2 hours in the attic last Friday crawling through, and probably the easiest and best thing to do for the building would be spray foam on the roof deck, the underside of the roof, because it solves a lot of the problems that we have with the unconditioned attic space and the heat loss. The problem is, when he provided me the quote for that, I almost fell out of my chair. Because it is really expensive. And it was over $400,000.
Wow. Who were they getting to do?
Surprising. Well, this was just an estimate, so we could apply for a Green Communities grant. But the return on investment, as you can imagine, the calculation is not going to work for a Green Communities grant.
I had spray foam done in my house.
Yeah.
All the roofs. And my house is not as big as the elementary school.
Yeah.
But I think it was in the thousands of dollars, but not the hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think, how much bigger is that roof than my house's roof? Is it 100 times bigger? I don't know, it could be, maybe, but I don't.
Yeah, so that was one of the options that was contained in the new master report. The other one was targeted air sealing and trying to get a certain percentage of, I'm not going to say it right, but a certain percentage of disconnect between the conditioned space and the attic space. I think it was 95% or something like that in terms of air. I think it's in terms of air leakage. But that air sealing doesn't address all of the problems with the building that bringing the attic into a conditioned space would. There's just a lot of things I think still to iron out. With that, the Green Communities grant now requires weatherization first before it will allow communities to apply for money for mechanicals. So we're also running up against the clock in terms of applying for the Green Communities grant. One of the options that we have is if we didn't apply for Green Communities this round, we could apply for a Meta grant, which is a Municipal Energy Technical Assistance Grant from the OER. They usually come out in the spring or summer, and that would give us, I think it's up to $10,000 to hire an energy efficiency engineer, expert, I don't know what the proper term is, and they could do a detailed analysis. They could start off from the UMass report and really investigate what's practical. Another component of the UMass report was they talked about heat recovery from the ventilation units.
Yeah.
But there's some significant challenges in getting those units into the attic. the only access into the attic right now is like a hatch that's about that size. And even in the attic, it's very, it would be a challenge. And challenge equals cost in most cases. So it may be that we might be, it might be more beneficial to have a detailed study done of the building. I know I've seen some in the past. I know there was one done in 2008. Doesn't sound right, but there was one done by, the last name was Bales.
Yeah, Bart.
Bart Bales. But it didn't really touch on weatherization. It touched on lighting, it touched on energy management system for the school, which both have been done.
Yeah.
It talked about boiler replacement, similar to what UMass had recommended. But
do you happen to remember, I'm sorry to go backwards to the phone, do you happen to remember the number of square feet they were going to cover?
I could ask him.
Okay, because I just pulled up the quote. It's almost 10 years ago. It was $2.60 per square foot.
And how, do you know how many inches that was, does it say?
I think it was 8 inches.
Okay, that's about what they're about recommending. 7-inch, it was 7-inch closed cell spray foam insulation.
Yeah, closed cell spray called Isonine. It's a, I thought, very reliable company out of Concealed.
Who was it?
They're called Advanced Insulation.
Okay.
I can shoot you their information.
Yeah. We would be under no obligation to go with the company that we had give us a quote, but if we put those quotes in the grant, the payback would never, they would never fund that.
Right.
Return on investment, because it would take around 150 years.
Yes, I mean, I'm guessing the materials cost have probably gone up, but not knowing the square footage. We know the square footage, we can certainly make an estimate of what it would cost us in 2011.
Right.
I'm happy to be in touch with them and ask for an updated cost. Because they're very straightforward. They're going to look at how many square feet, they're going to multiply it by the price per square foot, and then they're going to, that's what they're going to say.
Yeah. So, we're still trying to see if we can get our ducks in a row for the end of March. If not, I think it would really benefit us to go for a meta grant.
Okay.
To get some detailed proposals on some of the other items that they talked about, variable frequency drives for the air handler units. See if it's feasible to put in the heat recovery for the ventilation and things like that. Jonathan and I met with folks from Covestro. I know I mentioned that quickly. And they gave us an update on their facility at the back of the business park here. And they're doing very well. They're running shifts 24/7 now. So business is very good for them.
For the people at home, Covestro is the company.
Covestro
used to be called Deerfield Urethane.
I think so.
Yeah.
Which was used to be called Bayer. Used to be called
Bayer.
Covestro. Well, yeah. Deerfield Urethane, Bayer.
Mm-hmm.
Now Covestro.
Yeah.
It's at the back of the Whately Industrial Park. And they just wanted to let us know that eventually, if business keeps going, they have interest in expanding. And they wanted to just kind of feel out. The temperature of Whately, you probably know what infrastructure improvement I'm going to talk about in terms of connectivity between the Whately Industrial Park and the Deerfield parks, and their concerns about truck traffic on Pine Street and at the intersection of Pine Street and 116, and for also their employees who need to take a left off of Pine Street to 116, and the difficulties with that intersection is a important concern of theirs.
I completely agree with them.
So their next step is to try to reach out to the folks in Deerfield and I guess see what if the temperature has changed there.
Well, that will be the issue, has the temperature changed there or
right.
not? Because I think that was always the case, that we were always quite willing to cooperate.
Yeah.
And it came up quite a bit. Ambulance, where's your skims?
Yeah.
Site here, developing it, it was an issue.
Yeah. So that's what that meeting was about.
Okay.
I don't know if there's, I don't know if there's going to be any immediate action, but they wanted to.
Okay.
And their preliminary plan would be maybe asking the towns to jointly pursue a Mass Works grant that would pay for those infrastructure. We'll have to see what happens with that.
One concern we may have is they're expanding and doing more business is the water system, whether they can handle what's there or they need more. I think we have the capacity, you may want to check with Wayne what that is, and when it comes down to that, whether we need to add more to the infrastructure for their water usage, if it's going to increase a lot or not, or whether they can handle it the way it is. And of course, it's additional revenue as well for the water department, so.
Yeah. Yeah, and there's also a discussion that they're going to have with, if they do need to expand, whether they can access the sewer system in Deerfield.
Yeah.
Which my understanding is that they have a pretty significant capital investment to make, so.
They might want to have some of the.
Maybe willing to take on another rate payer that could help defray those costs, but obviously we can't speak for them, so.
Okay, well, I'm glad that's been tried again, that that's being approached.
Yep. All right, so the one thing I skipped over was town office contingency plan for COVID-19. And I've talked with Fran Fortino, he's the chairperson of the Board of Health. And the town of Deerfield has declared a state of emergency in response to, is it called a pandemic yet?
I think that today.
Called a pandemic.
Yeah.
So we're just, we've had conversations internally here about, what would we do if one of us had to quarantine and sort of what would happen with us. So there's those internal conversations happening. And then there's also I was talking to Fran about the Board of Health's stance, because the Board of Health has some authority in situations like this. They have some level of police powers to make decisions that are in the interest of public health. But right now they're willing to go along with, or feel like we should go along with the recommendations from the state, which are kind of what you had discussed earlier. Trying to avoid large gatherings. He did express concern about the annual town meeting. And we talked in detail about it, but he did ask if it was possible, if it could be postponed or moved back. And state law would allow us to move it back by a vote of the select board up until June 30th.
Okay.
And then if for some reason we needed to go even beyond June 30th, we would have to explore our legal options. We would have to involve town council and either get some special legislation or.
Okay. Well, it seems a little early to be postponing it.
It does.
But it's good to start thinking about that.
Right.
Now is the.
Right. I think it's important that we discuss what the option, know what the options are, if it's something that's by early April or whenever it's not calling down.
Yeah.
So that's the option that we have. So just to go back to sort of our operations here, Fran had recommended. He said something about ordering, but he said something about recommending that public buildings be cleaned on a more frequent basis, at least places that have high traffic.
Okay.
Which really in here is just kind of
that
area there.
Right. Okay.
Which is something I was going to talk to Keith about, and seeing if the custodian could come in more often. I know Janet's been doing a little bit on her own of doorknobs and stuff. But we don't have, on a regular basis, we don't have a lot of foot traffic that comes through. So we also talked about what would happen if one of us was presumed to have it or came in contact with somebody who had it. And what would happen sort of operationally if we had to, if we had to close this office?
I think you would still have to come to the selectmen's meetings.
I would.
You'd go by Zoom.
Could go by Zoom.
Zoom you in. We know how to do that.
Well, in those hypotheticals, it wasn't me that was sick, of course.
Oh, I see.
But my wife being a teacher, chances are, that's right.
She does, spends the whole day with all those little germ wagons.
Right. But we think operationally we'll be, we should be okay.
Yeah, okay.
So, if we had to close and disinfect the building for a week, we don't think there would be much we couldn't catch back up on.
Okay.
So, that's kind of what we've talked about internally. And then also what I've heard from the Board of Health. Wash your hands, avoid large gatherings, practice social distancing.
Notice how far, we are all at separate tables.
Yes, you guys are within 6 feet of each other though, so.
Okay, but that's, we're old.
That's worse.
Something happens to us and, you know, there'll be someone else to stand for election.
So, yeah, that's kind of where we are. We'll just kind of be prepared and see what happens.
All right.
So do we need to put anything on our website? Is that an option, or is there something that others are putting on the website? Other towns or something on this, or?
Deerfield declared a state of emergency, and it says, at the most, I think I would be comfortable with putting a link to the DPH.
Yeah.
I don't necessarily think people would come to our website for information about this, but we could put a link to the Department of Public Health recommendations.
That can't hurt.
Yeah.
But in terms of, in terms of declaring a state of emergency or something, fam didn't want to go down that path.
Yeah.
It's possible there could be some recovery of funds later, but I don't see us. It may be worthwhile if at some point we need to expend a good deal of money to, let's say the school needed to close and be cleaned. Mm-hmm. You know, it may be worthwhile for the, and I think it will come from the Board of Health to declare a
public
health emergency, and then there may be the possibility that they could recover those funds that were spent on whatever the hazmat company is that's going to come in and clean up the viruses that are dead after 2 hours. But so avoid large gatherings. I don't think I have any on my schedule. So I think that's probably a good rule of thumb for all of our employees.
Yeah.
And then I was also thinking about the Colonial Power meeting. Maybe we should suggest that that happen.
Or have a
online.
Have it be a call-in.
Yeah.
I think that would be good for on so many levels.
Yeah. So make that recommendation. So that's about it for town administrator updates.
Okay.
I think there's one other thing, but I can't remember it.
All right.
Items not anticipated. I just wanted to clarify something we talked about the other day in finance about the police chief's proposals.
Yep.
Are we getting more information from him, or is this it what we received so far?
he thinks that's the information you need.
Okay.
And I have told him that I did not agree, that it would have been better had he done, well, before yesterday's meeting, it's all before this. I haven't talked to him since. And I told him I didn't think that that was going to fly. I told him what I really thought he should do, and he decided not to do it. So he did some of it. He didn't make it. I think his presentation wasn't very clear, that there were other options besides putting on a whole nother full-time officer and only getting 4 more hours of coverage out of it. With, you know, anyway. So I think you're right. I think you shouldn't expect that he'll give you a lot more information. I'm just being realistic there. Not that he, not that it's not necessary. It's just that I don't think it's going to happen.
Okay. Because he keeps bringing up the fact of the administrative work that needs to be done.
Okay. Yeah. So in that context, at yesterday's meeting, he talked about administrative work. Okay. So he thinks of everything that's not him in a car responding to calls is administrative work. He one of the things he listed, community policing, was administrative work to him.
Oh, okay.
I don't think community policing is administrative work. I think it's his job.
Yeah.
So there are things that have to be done by a police officer. Like if there's a meeting he has to go to in Greenfield of whatever origin it is. I'm not doubting that those are meetings he has to go to.
Right.
It's not one that we could send. And I'll use our very capable Amy as an example. What if Amy were the administrative assistant for the police department? You couldn't probably send her to those meetings. We probably couldn't send her in the cruiser to go get the oil changed.
Right.
I mean, I think there's a lot of work that he has to do, that a police officer has to do, and a much smaller subset that a police officer does not have to do.
Right.
But I think that's much smaller. And he's calling all of this administrative, and I don't think that's to his benefit.
But and we asked him to further look at that and come up with just what we did last year.
Is
administrative,
yeah.
And which wouldn't maybe be a 40-hour position, but something less. If we or should we ask him
like,
that?
I believe he doesn't feel that there's a benefit.
He doesn't think
having an administrative assistant.
Right, because there's not that much of the things that he calls administrative could be turned over to another person.
Okay. So that's not going to help us anybody.
Right.
Asking.
I don't think that's something that he would want. I think it is. I think this topic is something that we should take up at the March 25th meeting when Jonathan's back,
right.
So that we can have a full discussion about it.
Yeah. I agree.
And it'll be before the sort of the final finance committee.
Yeah.
Discussions. We can give them updated numbers on what the board. Because
okay.
I think at the end of the discussion, Paul and Taya had suggested that the finance committee would be interested in.
It won't be thought.
Hearing what the board of selectmen wants to do.
Okay.
I just want to know if we were going to expecting or asking for any more information than what we already have.
If you'd like me to convey a recommendation or suggestion as to what you want to see, I'm happy to do that.
Well, the only thing would be, like I said, just the strict what we would call administrative kind of work, I guess. If
okay.
Right. So those are two definitions of administrative.
Because I guess you could say the office here does say administrative work, say for the water department.
Yeah.
You process all the payrolls, the payments, all that kind of stuff. That's
I think there is administrative
work for the water department. So, you know, that kind of work, whether it's done here or at his location, may be another option.
He's not administering his own payroll. He, you know, says who worked when and somebody else takes care of payroll, right?
Yeah, he submits a payroll like the rest of us. He compiles it, or someone there compiles
it,
and then gives it
to
Janet.
That's not hours and hours and hours.
I wouldn't.
That would be a small thing.
Right. Well, I'll give you that as an example of what other departments here use the
I agree.
The staff here for, and that if...
They use it in the same manner.
In the same manner that...
They do, yeah.
Okay. Well, okay, I guess you could ask if he wants to submit something else for us to consider and see what we get.
Well, I can talk about some of these.
Okay, let's get to the, should we just go from the start or from the personnel committee?
We can do personnel committee.
Okay. Yeah, because that's what I'm actually aware of.
So there's a memo in the packet where I laid out what the recommendations from the personnel committee are for fiscal year 2021. There's two of them. There's in terms of the salary adjustments that fall under the purview of the Board of Select Board, and then cost of living adjustment. So there's four recommendations from the personnel committee in terms of wage adjustments. And this is based on the 10-town survey that the personnel committee does of 10 comparable towns. So I don't know how we want to tackle these.
Yeah, this is not going to make it bigger so I can see it better. Yeah, I think there were not a lot of adjustments made. There were a few that were kind of more... This one doesn't actually show them what we voted, though, does it? This one?
No, this one does.
So that's the... Oh, yeah, that's the previous page, okay.
Yeah.
It's just one page behind. Okay, there we go. Yeah, there was only a handful. The town clerk, the senior operator, the transfer station attendant, and custodian. Town clerk made a very good case for herself. They had letters and also data from other towns. So we recommended sending the town clerk from $23.68 to $26 for the base rate that's before any COLA. Senior operator was also kind of out of line, so it went up by a little bit more than a dollar. The transfer station attendant went up by almost a dollar. That was also based on the median of the actual wage of similar communities. The custodian as well, similar communities, were at closer to $16.90, so we thought we could bring that up. We made recommendations for the folks that we don't control, so to speak, that like the library trustees, they hire their own employees. The water superintendent the water commissioners, right? So we made recommendations to the commissioners and the trustees about what we think are fair raises and gave them our data, and then it's theirs to make the decision. And then we're recommending a COLA of 2% based on CPI a few other pieces of data.
Okay. I have no problem with the four positions increase, I think one of our board members keeps bringing up the fact once you increase base that average, you're always increasing. Because now if we increase these and another town looks at the average for Franklin County, well, this is going to increase the average rate for everybody.
Right.
So
well,
it's
true, but in some cases, you know, if we had, for example...
I don't know how you would fix that, or maybe there is no way.
You can look at these and say, well, they're under by a little bit, but ours is a brand new person with no experience. Yeah. Maybe this year we don't do something with it. So it's more than just an automatic, it's something you can do with an Excel spreadsheet. I take your point that mathematically they'll always be going up. Especially if it's the same towns comparing to each other.
Right.
Yeah.
And the cost of living adjustment, I know what we used for the standard here. You've been using that before. Do we know what the Frontier School what Union 38 is doing for their cost of living?
2%.
They're going 2%?
Yeah.
Because last year...
It was 1%.
Yeah, it was different. We had, what, 2% last year?
No, 1% last year, 2% this year, 2% next year. Because they negotiate in three-year increments.
For the school?
Yeah.
So last year was 1, okay, this year's 2.
And then next year will be 2.
Yeah, but we were last year, we were what, 2?
1.75, I don't know. We were more than 1.5, I think. Or maybe we were 2.25. I feel like we were just, like, split between two numbers and then we went halfway between.
But it might have been 2.25.
It might have been 2.25.
2.25 was one of the years.
Yeah.
The school's on a step system.
Yeah, because they're also on a step system.
Right.
So people who are lower down will get more than the cost of the degrees.
Right.
But we don't, yeah, I mean, so that was actually a useful comparison number, since the CPI was running just north and south of 2.0, mostly north of that. And then we thought, well, you know, the schools are getting 2%, seems...
I just didn't see that anywhere near what the school was getting.
Oh, yeah, I don't think it's in there. So this is this something, we don't approve this necessarily, or do we say?
You would approve these, right?
Oh, okay. We approve the recommendations of the personnel committee on pay raises and cost of living adjustments.
As proposed here on this March 10th memorandum.
Memorandum, yes.
Yeah. Okay, I second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So, in theory, if the Finance Committee didn't agree, they could include a lower number in their budgets.
Right.
And then we get into the back and forth of, which we
hopefully
try not to.
Our Finance Committee are very agreeable.
So has Union 38 approved theirs? Has it been approved already?
They have I don't know how much I can say about details, but my understanding is they've agreed to a one-year contract and to negotiate some particular things that came up late. And so their contract will probably be offset from everybody else's. They'll get a three-year contract that they're starting to negotiate now. And I hope I didn't say something I wasn't supposed to say, but I don't know the details of what's in that one-year contract. That's the stuff that I'm sure I'm not allowed to talk about until it's really decided. But there was a lot of trouble getting an agreement between the negotiating committee and the union. I think that much is clear.
Okay, that has to be approved or finalized, whatever, before we can approve their budget?
No, they could carry estimates. So their current budget has an estimate to account for those.
Oh, okay.
For those additional salary costs. That's what they did last year.
And what is that, the 2% or 1?
I'm not sure what they don't carry remember. This year.
Oh, okay.
They didn't come back asking us for money for this year, so I assume it was within what?
What
they anticipated.
It was surely within what we had estimated.
And it will be in that same boat in FY 2021, depending on when or if it gets resolved this year. It took essentially the whole year to come to an agreement for a single year.
Okay. So,
okay.
Yep.
Okay.
Shall we go backwards?
Let's just go backwards.
I know the wood chipper is broken.
Oh, it's officially broken. It's been declared broken.
It's been declared broken. Okay. And that's what Keith wanted to talk about. So
Did he mention any numbers of repair cost estimates or whether it's worth repairing?
He had an insurance appraiser look at it. And I think he just said it's probably totaled.
Oh.
Meaning the cost of repairs are worth more than the actual value of the wood chipper. So I suggested he buy a wood chipper attachment to his excavator.
Okay. How old is this wood chipper? Do we know?
I think it's close to 20 years old.
Close to 20 years old. So that might be its usable
lifetime.
What's
it more cost?
I think ballpark, I think 60 grand.
60, okay.
An attachment to...
Attachment to the excavator, right?
Right. But you were joking.
I was joking about that, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, see, we can put that on Natalie Blake's, ask her for $60,000.
Would ship her.
We'll share one with someone.
Well, she can pay for 5/6 of it.
Yeah, we'll share one with her. Like we do the...
Bucket truck?
No, the brush thing.
Oh, yeah, the mower, right?
The mower, brush mower.
Oh, we share that mower with like...
Yeah, more than Sunderland, yeah.
12 towns or... No, it's not that, it's 8 towns. We share the bucket truck though with Sunderland.
Oh, we do, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so that may not, will that be in this year's budget, do you think? Is that going to make it in?
That's what we need to talk about.
Okay.
Our...
Capital Improvement Committee has...
Didn't know about it.
Oh, yeah, will they be finding out and adding their voice, or will that really be between...
It'll prob, they probably will not have a recommendation at this late in the game.
Okay, so, but we might not be hearing from Keith about it tonight.
What else is he asking for?
But he's asking for a...
Well, for excavators.
Right.
Whatever, okay, no other vehicles, so...
Yeah.
Nothing else.
No, I mean, quite honestly, the pool of capital items is growing fast.
Yeah.
And the number of free cash that we have hasn't grown at all since October, because it doesn't.
It doesn't grow, right.
So we're going to have to make some decisions about what's important and what can be deferred, for sure.
Yeah, wood chipper does not sound like something that can be deferred for very long.
Right.
So...
Yep.
Okay, well, I think there may be people better able to weigh in on the priorities there.
Right.
And, for example, Keith.
Right, and that's pretty much the meeting on the finance meeting on the 24th is when we'll have a big spreadsheet.
Okay.
Here's the projects, here's the money.
Right.
Let's make it work.
Okay, so we have sidewalk reconstruction and Williamsburg Road Bridge project. And vote to send a letter to Mass DOT requesting additional funding. I thought it was politely worded and had lots of relevant detail in it. So I would not stand in the way of that letter getting sent.
I just asked Brian to explain the spreadsheet on the back page.
So this is from Time Bond. So the opinion of probable construction cost. That first, the middle column that says total, that's what they told us pre-grant.
That was their estimate.
Yeah, that was the estimate.
Okay.
And then Time Bond Agreement with Whately, July 2017. This is what they were anticipating we were going to have for engineering costs.
Okay. Engineering, okay.
And the last column is total construction costs and increased engineering costs. So design, bidding, construction. And then there were additional costs related to some investigations that they needed to do, some subsurface investigations, additional environmental permitting, and then the Conservation Commission had a lot of concerns about it, and the City of Northampton had a lot of concerns about it, because the two bridges are immediately upstream of the brook that goes into the lower reservoir.
Yeah.
So there's an estimate of an additional $12,000 for water quality monitoring, and there were a lot of some other changes that the CONSCOM wanted in terms of how the construction would take place, which increased project costs. And I mean, one of the difficulties that the practical difficulties a contractor has, as it's alluded to really briefly in here, is that in order to get to, so there's really two bridges right next, within, I don't know, 500 feet of each other. So in order to, if you're going to access from the Conway Road side, from,
yeah,
you know, if you know what I mean.
Far side.
Yeah, from the Whately side, you can go over the new bridge and you can access the lower bridge.
Uh-huh.
Fine. And you can access But in order to get over that one, to get to the middle or to come from the Williamsburg siding, there's another one that's, there's a third one, that culvert that also needs to be replaced. That's not part of this project. But there's concerns about the integrity of that and what contractors would have to do to armor that culvert to get their equipment.
Reinforce it.
Yeah, so there's some logistical things and there's some things about if they're, as they're excavating soil and they're going to dewater it, it needs to be done essentially below the dam. So that any type of dewatering that takes place has to happen below the dam. Any stockpiles of material needs to happen below the dam, material storage, portable toilets, any of that. So it's a complicated site, which doesn't lend to it being a cheap project. All the four bids that we got, this was the lowest bid, and all of them were really within,
They're not extremely much
$80,000 to $100,000 of each other. But that's what the sheet shows.
Okay, so we're asking the bottom line differences from 497.8 to 891.
Yep.
So we're asking for another almost 400,000. Okay.
Yep.
What we've already committed or spent is the 207,200 for engineering. Or some of that still future. Well, water monitoring. Okay, I see you got that and
right. So
environmental permitting, maybe. But
what we've incurred. I'd have to double check, but I think it's the 113. We're through design, we're through bidding.
Yeah.
So that's probably the 113,500. They haven't done construction oversight yet.
Right, okay.
They've also done some of that geotechnical stuff.
Okay, so we're almost 400.
Yeah.
Sure.
Right. So what we're asking for this amount would presume that the contractor does everything.
Right.
So this is the amount from the total bid.
Okay. Which may be different than what it will actually cost us if we do some of the work ourselves.
Yeah, Keith's estimate is not including labor would cost around $15,000. And the alternate one for the contractor was
$81,000. Yeah. What do the two footnotes here apply to? I have a hard time figuring out where that goes or how that's used. Is that used anywhere in this spreadsheet? What? It's showing the engineering news record. I guess index, construction cost index.
Footnote one references, it's at the opinion of probable construction cost.
Okay. Right, format, okay.
And the cost and cost under engineering costs, they represent projected costs. So I think that's the water quality monitoring. We don't know exactly what the water quality monitoring costs will be, but they're projecting it'll be up to $12,000.
So the small, bridge grant application in June of 2017 was 497, and if you could apply the engineering news record difference, I guess then flight that to a higher number, what does that come out to? Has anybody looked at that? What percent is 11,322 over 10,703?
Say that
you have to get this? 11,322 divided by 10,703.
That says 1.058.
Okay, times 497.8.
It's 526.6.
Didn't go up a whole lot in 4 years.
Yep.
3 years there.
Yep.
I think, yeah, you've got a lot of points in here, a lot of information.
Most of the narrative is from the engineer.
Engineer, yeah. And Keith, is agreeable with this?
I sent it out. I wrapped this up this afternoon, so I sent it out to him.
Okay. I thought it laid things out clearly and simply, the numbers add up. And that doesn't guarantee that they'll give us the money, but you've given them no excuses to not give it. Right.
Did you like my line about the town of Whately is unable to bridge the gap between previously awarded
that
funds and total
so
project costs?
Yes.
I was
so
laughing
proud.
In my office alone.
Laugh with us here. Bridge the gap, get it? Okay. So, is there a vote required on this?
Yeah, I think it would be good to have it on record that we voted to send a letter.
Okay.
And I'll take the draft off and we'll have you sign this. And what was your thing?
The Richards
letter.
Letter.
Yeah. Okay.
I would make a motion then that we sign this letter and send it along.
I guess the one thing I'd maybe like to see,
yep,
stronger language, the last paragraphs, I guess, saying that we'd like to discuss this with you. Your regret, rather than say if you have questions, I think it's like,
yep,
we're sending it off and we hear fine. If not, I think we need a stronger position here or a comment that we want to discuss it with you if you have questions. You can read it all, but still, I guess there's more intricacies of the estimate and all that that, you know, you explained some of that to me here, that people at MassDOT, well, I don't know.
Yeah.
They have a lot of other things to look at. And
yeah, I know our engineer has been in touch and has talked about this with the District 2 bridge,
yeah,
engineer. So the bridge engineer's actually seen he's actually seen this already. But yeah, I think we can definitely strengthen the language.
Yeah.
So I think this letter's more formality than it is substance, because I know that they already have this information.
Yeah. Right.
They wanted something from the town.
Right.
But we can strengthen that language.
Yeah, I'd like to see that strengthened. Okay.
Will that
change it?
Okay.
You agree with that?
I agree with that, yeah.
Okay, motion to send this letter, have Joyce sign the letter as chairperson.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. And I think last thing is the sidewalk reconstruction project.
Just another comment here. Is this gone, or is our finance committee aware of this, or any of this detail?
Yes.
Yeah,
we
talked about
it. Meeting,
yeah, we talked a little bit about it last night. They know that we have
okay.
the shortfall from
yeah. Okay.
the capital stabilization.
Okay.
The reason for the capital stabilization appropriation.
Right, but we only for the warrant article?
Yeah.
I think in the context of the warrant article, we told them about how
right,
using
okay.
saved up chapter 90 money.
Right, okay.
Yeah. Okay, last item. We might be able to get out of here before 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
And that is the sidewalk reconstruction project status.
Yep. So Keith and I, at the end of last meeting, Keith and I were going to meet with Chip Clock to see what if any contribution that they could make, because part of the project is on extends beyond the right of way onto private property. So he's willing to verbally he's made a financial commitment to the project.
Oh, that's very generous.
Yeah, in an amount that should cover the work that needs to be done on on his part of the property. So I've asked town council for a draft agreement.
Okay.
And it's actually this should be an agreement that we can use twice, because there's also the arrangement with hopefully Smith College is losing money, because we have their verbal commitment to donate for Poplar Hill Road.
Okay.
Okay, yeah.
So town council's going to be getting us an agreement that we could enter into to just make sure that we're committed to him and he's committed to us. So then I think the other reason we wanted to put it on here was, I think we're pretty much ready to put it out to bid.
Yeah, now that we have that.
I don't know if there's any outstanding questions that you had.
Oh, I still want speed bumps and sort of, our process was good. We got a lot of input from a lot of places. And it doesn't have every feature that I would like, but I think it's going to be an improvement.
See how it goes. We can always make changes.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we can use that agreement for our North Hatton Water Department as well.
All right, I'll send it to him.
Send it to him.
Sign here.
Yeah.
At least cover the water quality monitoring.
Yeah. Alrighty.
But even that, if I remember what Keith said last time was that the crosswalk part of it, was not going to be part of the, that was something that he was going to do as part of the road repaving, the crosswalk.
Oh, he'll paint the crosswalks himself and put in the little shiny reflectors?
Yeah, I think so. So we're okay with no flashing beacon. We're going to do the reflectors on the pavement.
Took out the beacon.
Right.
I wonder how they're going to like the little solar powered speed sign.
You see the other ones that Sunderland has? The bar, not on the sign. It's a bar underneath it that flashes.
Oh.
But only when somebody pushes a button.
Yeah, that might not. It is really, really, really bright.
Yeah, that one. Yeah. Sunderland.
It would make the lamp by the town hall look dim.
Yeah. Just thinking more about the bridges and the landowners that are around there, North Hatton Water Department and I guess the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, they don't pay any property taxes, right?
North Hampton pays a pilot.
Okay, but...
And the Commonwealth pays a ridiculously small amount for state-owned land.
But I'm thinking,
other
communities get donations from these agencies that don't, public agencies that don't pay property tax, or full property tax that, these that we have there maybe are getting away easy. Maybe that's something we should, as it comes to maybe a more a political decision discussion or however you want to say it to help the town out.
When we have something that they want, that's when we will be able to negotiate something with them.
Okay, and maybe that's a position or something to talk to our representatives here about these agencies that don't pay tax. How can we get them to contribute?
That is an ongoing conversation in Western Mass. For sure.
Yeah.
There are towns in Berkshire County that the state owns 70-80% of their land they don't have a way to generate additional tax revenue because the land's not ever going to be developed. There's always talk about the state increasing.
Right, but other than you also got the North Hatton Water Department that...
Yeah, so
presumably that pilot is a negotiated thing.
Yeah, state law is pretty strict as to how it lets, it sets out how municipalities can tax each other's water, drinking water.
I'm so shocked that the state thinks that they would insert themselves into that agreement between two neighboring towns.
Yeah.
And that they would know what's best for us.
They always know what's best for us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's in part of it could be looked at how the land is assessed. I believe there's actually there's a relevant date in time when the watershed land was acquired as to how it can be assessed and how the pilot permit works. Because we also have South Deerfield Water District, right? Northampton.
Yeah.
Those are the only water the water supplies we have that are outside of Whately. And we tax the Whately Water District too, but hopefully they won't exist for much longer, so.
Okay, well, I think we're at the end of our agenda. Is there anything else that you want to add, Brian, or that you want to add, Fred?
No.
But I would entertain a motion.
Sure.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thanks.